Thank you for joining us today. We will not have our signers today for a lot of demand for this right now. We do have closed captioning, so thank you for joining us. It is hard to believe that 19 years have passed since September 11th. I know we all knew we were where we were that day, and I was thinking I was walking back to my congressional office building, and shortly thereafter saw the smoke from the fires of the Pentagon. And so as we honor not only the loss, but the heroes in United Flight 93 that went down in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, it's very personal for me because that flight, we think, was headed for the Capitol, and my friends and other folks in Congress were potential victims that were saved by the heroism of the Todd Beamer and the other people on that flight that showed the courage to prevent another tragedy from happening. We thank them. We honor them. We still embrace their families. I got to meet Mr. Beamer's widow and shortly after that, and I hope they know that that heroic legacy is something that we continue to honor in our state. As we honor those who are still serving in Afghanistan, we appreciate their service. I want to comment, obviously, on our fires today. This has been a cataclysmic event in the state of Washington. We have so many families that have had such profound losses. When we saw the pictures of the one-year-old boy in the Colville region, to see that young life lost is something I know everybody felt in the state of Washington, and we all are hoping for the best recovery for his parents. It is families who have lost their homes from many places across the state of Washington, and I think that's perhaps a little unexpected, but this is a fire threat across the state of Washington. We know it both in eastern and western Washington, and it's something we share. We'll have some other folks available today. State Patrol Chief John Batiste, General Brett Daugherty, our National Guard, Robert Azell, our Director of State's Emergency Management, and also Laura Watson, who leads our Department of Ecology. I wanted to report just a little bit of what I saw on our efforts to work with people across the state the last few days. When I went to the Sumner-Bonnie Lake area and the Sumner Grade Fire in East Pierce County and met Fire Chief Bud Backer, I got a feeling of what we're up against here. Chief Backer told me that these fires are now so extraordinary because of the low humidity. He said that when humidity gets down to 20%, typically, in many cases, fire chiefs will have to pull their people off the line because these fires can just are unrestrained in those conditions. And it got down to 8% in that Sumner Grade Fire. This is in western Washington. These are extraordinary conditions that we are facing because of changes that are going on in our state. And it's one of the reasons we are so appreciative of him and his troops who are showing the courage to fight these fires. When I visited Malden and Whitman County, I saw the heroism of a deputy, Mike Melcher, a graduate of Washington State University, who responded to the fire and successfully was involved in an evacuation of that town so that no lives were lost, even though this fire was just a cataract, a river of fire that came through there from the northeast that destroyed 80% of the structures in the town. I made him Washingtonian of the day as a representative of all of the people who are being so professional and so courageous fighting these fires and responding to the emergency. And obviously not just professionals, neighbors are helping neighbors. We're seeing that across the state of Washington. What I saw in Malden yesterday sort of struck me as the alpha and omega of our experience in these crises. I met a woman who said she'd moved there a few years ago seeking kind of a dream of living in a quiet small town in a beautiful place, and that is a beautiful place amongst the wheat fields, and living a quiet life with her neighbors in a small town. And when she explained how that dream has been snuffed out and she just broke down in tears, it's something that you feel very powerfully, because when a person leaves their home, loses their home, it's not just an economic loss. It's not just a balance sheet. It's people who feel unmoored from security. And the loss of their family memories and photographs is something that when I've talked to people in Malden, it's the most painful thing. But on the other side of that, I met a family of three, two parents, and about a 12-year-old, maybe 13-year-old young woman. In fact, the picture's on the screen here. They were explaining to me they were away from town at the time of the fire, but when they got back, their home was gone, totally gone. And we started talking about the challenges that they will have now, financial and otherwise, from the loss of their home. And I turned to this young woman there and I said, I know your parents are going to have some really tough days ahead, but I know that you are a very, very strong young woman, and you're going to lead your family and support your parents and make sure that they have confidence moving forward, because you look like a strong, confident leader. And her face just kind of lit up when I said that. And to see a smile amongst the ashes, it does your heart well. And we're seeing that too, of people being strong, helping each other. And I want to applaud the leaders in Malden who are helping their families and their neighbors right now. We want to help as much as we can, obviously, in the state. That's why yesterday I issued a proclamation to provide cash assistance to these families who've been impacted by these fires. This program will be administered by our Department of Social and Health Services. And we know our residents are dealing with multiple challenges, fires, COVID-19, and economic crises. The need is substantial. I hope that this is a small thing to help people across some of the troubled days that we know that are ahead. We're doing some of the logistical things that are necessary. The demand for fire retardant is obviously very high. There have not been enough truck drivers actually to deliver that, so we've waived some of the requirements that would otherwise restrain the ability for truck drivers to deliver this important product. A report on the fires: as of this morning, we've had 14 active large fires, and they've burned 626,982 acres. And these are just the active fires, not the ones that have already been contained and where recovery continues. I want to put this in context to understand what we're up against. The fires that we have suffered just in the last 5 days, just in those 5 days, are the most fire in any total year in the history of the state of Washington except for 2015. This is an extraordinary event over a very short period of time. Hitting by these bombs. About 1,000 people actually have been evacuated, and some 3,000 homes and other buildings are threatened still at this moment. Now, we're seeing perhaps, if it's possible, even worse damage in Oregon. I've spoken to Governor Brown, who's leading her state's efforts, and we want to help to the extent possible, including for folks who were evacuated from Oregon. We know there's been tens of thousands of people evacuated from their homes. We are now looking for options for them in Washington, including in an effort to give them kind of a central way through the Red Cross and otherwise to find housing and hotels and the like in the state of Washington. We want to be good neighbors. We've also had our National Guard in communication with the Guard in Oregon. Other than hand crews and aerial assets, if our guard could be of assistance, that's something that we hope to make available as appropriate. So I hope all of us can find ways to be good neighbors. One of the ways we can be good neighbors is try to stay off the roads, particularly in southern Washington, in the next few days, because we do expect people will be traveling because of these evacuations. Now I'd like to turn it over to Chief Batiste to talk a little bit about how we coordinate our efforts. Chief Batiste.
Thank you, Governor. On behalf of the men and women of the Washington State Patrol, our hearts continue to be with those impacted by the fires throughout the state of Washington, to our friends down in Oregon and California. I've been in contact with the superintendent of the Oregon State Police, Superintendent Travis Hampton, as well as the Commissioner of the Highway Patrol, Warren Stanley. We stand ready to assist in any way possible, in particular with the potential evacuees who will be headed to the state of Washington. Of the major fires that are occurring here within the state of Washington, our state fire marshal's office has resources dispatched to 10 of the major fires. We have incident command coordinators working with the fire's incident command officers on scene to ensure that they have the necessary tools and resources available to them that they may ask for. We do want to debunk some rumors that are occurring here within the state and elsewhere. There's rumors that there are coordinated efforts to start fires. We are unaware of any evidence of coordinated activities to set fires. Troopers have in fact arrested two individuals here in Pierce County for starting fires. We have no evidence that those two individuals were connected in their efforts, or nor were they tied into any larger scheme to set fires to our knowledge. We are asking drivers to please use your ashtrays and don't toss lighted materials from your windows. We ask motorists to slow down and turn on your headlights in hazy conditions. And we're asking everyone to please pay attention to your surroundings. Please follow media coverage regarding the fires and follow evacuations notices immediately upon hearing of them. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. Thank you. General Daugherty, could you give us a report?
Sure. Thank you, Governor. As you know, in addition to the Washington Guardsmen that we currently have serving in Afghanistan and the Middle East, we have 1,000 soldiers and airmen that are responding here in Washington to our COVID-19 pandemic response by providing food, building test kits, running test sites, and assisting with contact tracing. So now we have mobilized additional soldiers and airmen to help fight the wildfires that we face. Today, we mobilized 3 firefighting hand crews and put them on the road to Davenport. They'll be there shortly. They're going to be fighting the Whitney fire starting tomorrow morning and then be deployed from there wherever DNR needs them. They're joining 2 UH-60 Black Hawk helicopters and crews that have been dropping water on the fires near Sumner and Greenwater over this last week. We also have a Lakota helicopter and crew that is helping DNR to identify the hot spots and to help map the boundaries of the fires to give them good intelligence about what those fires are doing. Additionally, we are also in touch with our friends in Oregon. I reached out last night to General Mike Stensel, my counterpart in Oregon, and assured him that we are standing ready to assist them in any way that we can, especially if they need to evacuate here into Washington. That concludes my report, Governor. Back to you.
General, I want to thank your leadership to train up these crews in firefighting. That you were very farsighted in doing that. I don't think every general has done that in the states. So thanks for preparing these people that are trained and ready to go. And I'm glad you're getting them to Eastern Washington and Davenport. And we hope for every success with the Davenport guerrillas. With that, Robert Ezell, could you give us a report? You there, Robert? You there, Robert? Are you on mute, Robert? How are we doing with Robert? So Robert is unmuted, but not quite coming through. So why don't I continue, and a little later, Robert, if you can stay with us, see if we can figure out what the hang-up is here. If I can, I wanted to answer some questions that we've had since I've been talking to people around the state about these fires, about the cause of these fires and what we can do about them, you know, other than depend on our courageous and professional firefighters. And I think the answers are kind of 3 buckets, if you will. One is that we continue to be impressed that some people have been able to save their homes by being firewise. And it's really interesting, as I've gone to these fires, frequently you'll see 1, 2, 3 houses burned and then 1 house that has survived. And sometimes it's been explained to me it's because those homes have cleared their shrubbery, cleared their area of anything that's combustible, got pine needles out of the gutter. And some of those simple things can actually save homes. So there's something that all of us could do to try to firewise our properties. It can really pay off to save a home. Second, we know there's things we can do to reduce the intensity of these fires by removing some of the combustible material in our forests to provide some active management of our forests to remove some of the unnecessarily dense combustible material in these forests. And we are doing that. We're spending millions of dollars in the state doing that today to try to make our forests a little bit more or less combustible. But that is a huge challenge because we have hundreds of thousands of acres, and the most we can do is a small percentage a year. So we want to continue those efforts. But a third issue is a more fundamental issue. Right now we have a state that is just a tinderbox. And the reason is because of the low humidity, the high temperatures, and obviously the winds. And these are conditions that are becoming much more frequent in our state. That's why we've had three of the last 5 years, some of the worst fires in our state's history. And we know that that is because our environment is changing, our climate is changing. These are not just wildfires, they are climate fires. And we cannot, and we will not, surrender our state and expose people to have their homes burned down and their lives lost because of climate fires. We need to act, and we need to put people to work, building clean energy jobs to fight climate change. And we know what this is not some problem that can be 10 or 20 years away. It's this Monday when these fires exploded. These are already upon us. And when I look in the eyes of people who've lost their home and see their tears, I think these people deserve a response to try to protect them and to try to remove the threats that threaten their future and those of future communities. We've had too many towns burned down already. And I look forward to our state being unified to try to fight this scourge. I'd like to address another health threat we have, and that's the smoke from fires. We know that the entire West Coast is on fire, and we don't expect air quality to improve until Monday at the earliest. Parts of the state are already experiencing hazardous conditions, and you can learn more about your area by going to wasmoke.blogspot.com. And so I hope people will consider staying home this weekend unless you really have to go out. And if you haven't been told to evacuate, this is actually a kind of an important issue. And it's two things that for safety we need. One, if you are advised to evacuate, please follow the advice. It's your life that ultimately we care about. But if you haven't been told to evacuate, it's not necessary to do so. And we want to leave the roads free for fire trucks and people who do have to evacuate. So we hope we don't get unnecessary traffic jams. I want to turn this over now to Ecology Director Laura Watson for discussion of air quality. Laura.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Governor. As folks may be aware, we did see a large plume of smoke develop from the California and Oregon wildfires. That plume moved out over the ocean, and starting last night and into today, we're starting to see it move over the state of Washington. And as a result, as you saw in the governor's map that he showed with the colored dots, we are seeing unhealthy, very unhealthy, and hazardous levels of air pollution throughout the state. The Puget Sound region woke up to unhealthy levels. We're seeing hazardous, very unhealthy levels in Southwest Washington and some parts of the coast, and we're expecting that plume of smoke will continue to travel across the state and will reach Spokane by probably tomorrow afternoon, Saturday afternoon. So as the governor said, it is a good time to stay inside, to catch up on your Netflix watch list or a book or get some board games and puzzles, and stay out of the outside as much as we can because the air quality is unhealthy throughout much of the state. Also encourage folks to access the resource that the governor mentioned, the wasmoke.blogspot.com provides up-to-date information about air quality in your area. including specific about small particles. One thing to keep in mind is that just because you can't see it doesn't mean that you can't breathe it. And when we're talking about wildfire smoke, what we're worried about are those small particles, what we call PM2.5. And that resource on the website can let you know about what the 2.5 levels are in your area of the state and help you make the right decision to keep yourself safe, your family safe, and your pets safe. Thank you, Governor.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks, Laura, for our health. We have Robert Ezell. Robert, are you on now?
I hope.
Maybe not. Okay, Robert, I'm sorry. We're going to have to defer. We'll get you next time. Before we stand for questions, we had some good news we announced, I think, yesterday, and that is we are allowing indoor fitness training facilities to reopen in Douglas, Chelan, Yakima, Benton, and Franklin counties under Phase 2 guidance. These are the latest activities that we are opening up under our modified Phase 1 counties. We've been able to do this because we've been encouraged by continued improvement in our rates of transmission. And so after careful consideration, we've been able to do this to help these businesses and people who need to exercise. So that means facilities like gyms and yoga studios and indoor sports facilities can open for personal fitness and training. But this is with a limited occupancy to ensure that we have appropriate social distancing. We're glad to be able to make that progress. We do have Dr. Kathy Lofi on the line if you have questions about healthcare today. And with that, for questions to any of our group, feel free. Happy to stand for your questions.
First question comes from Rachel with AP.
Governor, how is the state balancing the need to protect those who are vulnerable to this air quality with the COVID pandemic?
Well, we believe that they're not mutually exclusive. We can suggest to people to avoid unnecessary outdoor activity, particularly those who have compromised health systems. But there's certainly ways to be inside and not be within 2 feet of other people. And so we just encourage people to use their common sense. It's not really the right time to have a lot of people in your home, period. And if there's other people in your home, spread out, wear a mask, and avoid those as necessary for the next few days. We think we can do this. We've demonstrated this. As I've said before, Washingtonians have been showing a lot of common sense and a lot of scientific literacy because they've been wearing masks, because they've been social distancing, because business leaders have been accommodating and protecting their employees. That's the reason we are the eighth best state in the nation in keeping our infection rates low. So we believe Washingtonians can do both. We hope they'll continue in that successful effort.
Rachel, would you like to ask a follow-up?
Yes, Governor, what about populations though that don't have access to housing, the homeless or those who are working outdoors, particularly agriculture community?
Well, for agriculture workers, we've been diligent in insisting on protection and masks and cohorting and distancing and transportation and the like. We've had pretty strong regulations in that recall in that area, and we are enforcing them. We've taken some enforcement action and now have a new testing protocol over, and I know we've done hundreds, if not more, people over in the Brewster area. So we have a very robust area effort to protect the agricultural workers. It has not eliminated the risk, but we've done a lot to reduce it. These are some of the hardest working people in our state, and they deserve all the protection that we can give them. So for ag workers, we've done a lot. For those without housing, I'm told that King County in Seattle is going to be opening some specific sheltering options for folks like that. Now, we have to be very careful when we do that, because what we normally do is have a lot of people in one room close together in a congregate setting. We want to avoid that during COVID. So I'm confident that they will provide space in those indoor settings to try to keep people protective. So we encourage anybody's efforts. I know the Red Cross has done some extraordinary work in this regard, and we're going to keep up that effort.
Next question comes from Joe with the Seattle Times.
Yes, question for Chief Batiste. You mentioned that you know, the rumors of coordinated fire setting, or there's no evidence of them, but you also mentioned the two arrests in Pierce County. I was just out on a rally on the Capitol lawn, and people were saying, oh, those arrests in Pierce County, you know, that's possible evidence that there was some sort of coordinated intent. How do you describe to people, first of all, can you give some details of those arrests, what nature they were for, and how would you describe to people the difference and the distinction in those cases?
Well, thank you for the question. We've arrested two individuals, as I indicated, within Pierce County, both in the valley, setting fires on one on Highway 512 at State Route 7. A trooper actually witnessed that taking place. The one in the valley on State Route 167 was witnessed by citizens who called it in. A trooper responded, could not detect that there was actual nefarious activities occurring. Shortly afterwards, a five police officer came along and witnessed the individual setting the fire, and that person, along with the other person, was taken into custody. Again, we have no indication that there's a linkage between those two individuals. We know that there's a lot of rumors spreading around on social media about an organized effort to set fires, but we have no knowledge of that. We've not been able to discover any of that in conversations throughout the fire community and amongst law enforcement.
Yeah, follow up for the governor or anyone else. Can anyone lay out how we're doing in terms of firefighting resources right now in terms of manpower and whether we're stretched thin or feel comfortable going into the weekend here?
General, do you want to talk about that?
Sure thing, Governor. Glad to. I can certainly speak to the National Guard. We are stretched a little thin on helicopters due to my overseas deployments that we have going on right now, but I have an additional two that we could surge if necessary, and that's quite a bit of capacity. They're both Blackhawks. And I do have an additional seven firefighting hand crews at our disposal. When you look across the entire West Coast, you know, the entire firefighting community is stretched a little bit thin. It typically happens this way. California catches on fire in a big way first, and then it's Oregon, and then it's finally Washington. We're all burning at the same time this year, although certainly California and Oregon have consumed a lot of assets. But in my conversations with our partners at DNR, they're feeling pretty confident that we've got the forces rallied that will see us successfully through this weekend, and I feel the same way.
Allison, are you there?
I am. I don't have a question at this time. Thanks.
Okay. Next question comes from Alexis with the News Tribune.
I'm wondering where specifically families who have been affected by the wildfires can turn for help and where people who want to help those families can donate right now.
Well, people who have been affected by climate fires, these climate fires have caused enormous grief in our people. And it's just not economic, it is psychological. For psychological help, we encourage people to get a mental health treatment as appropriate, because this is very, very stressful for people. And we suggest that as appropriate, if you're suffering from a climate fire and you're having real challenges, call a professional and perhaps get some assistance. It's something we certainly encourage, and there's many avenues to get that type of treatment. Obviously, the Red Cross has done extraordinary work. They mobilized so quickly. They were there yesterday in Malden, as was our DSHS facility. Our DSHS facility will be administering the cash program to try to get some cash to people. Now, you have to qualify. It's not for everyone in all circumstances. But at DSHS, we actually have a van that was there the day after the fire in Malden. And so that will be a program available under DSHS. Going forward, we will be looking for any avenue to obtain federal assistance for individuals and for municipalities.
And to do that, we have to qualify for a federal disaster designation. We hope that next week we will be in a position to assess the amount of damage that we've had in the hopes that we can obtain a federal designation. Now, that requires some discretionary decisions by this administration. We hope that they will look at the devastation we have suffered. And if we qualify, we certainly will be assertive in arguing with the administration for this assistance. That some of that can help for individual families in a variety of ways. And it can also help municipalities. And that's important too. In Malden, every single city asset was totally destroyed. And so, and there is frankly better coverage for that type of public asset through the Federal Disaster Relief Fund. So we are gonna gather up our information about losses and make the best case we can to the federal government to obtain assistance.
Alexis, would you like to ask a follow-up?
I would. I'm wondering about what early indications the state has about the effects of wildfire smoke and the spread of COVID-19 converging. In terms of symptoms, I'm wondering if the state's hearing from providers or local health jurisdictions yet about what those symptoms are looking like, or if it's too soon to know what some of those effects might be.
Dr. Lofi, would you like to address that?
Yeah, so I guess the first thing I'll say is that there is an overlap in the symptoms that people can experience when they inhale a significant amount of wildfire smoke and when they have COVID-19. We know that people who are outside, you know, in poor air quality can experience coughing and wheezing and difficulty breathing. And as you know, these are some of the same symptoms that can be experienced with COVID-19. As well. Clearly, we have, you know, lots of testing set up in case somebody sees a healthcare professional and is unsure, you know, which condition the patient may have. A COVID test will help alleviate that. We do often see an increase of people presenting to some of our emergency departments throughout the state when we have wildfires. So in past seasons, when there have been wildfires, we can see an uptick in people who are visiting emergency rooms with respiratory symptoms, but it's, I think, a little bit too early to know, you know, exactly what that looks like yet.
If I can add something on our COVID-related issue, yesterday I also went to Pullman and met with student leaders and administration leaders at WSU and business and the police department. And I was very encouraged about some of the efforts they're making to reduce COVID transmission, particularly in the college population. We've had a very severe outbreak in Pullman, several hundred new cases, because we've had people returning to Pullman back to school. And even though the students are not going to class physically, they're having mostly remote learning, they are congregating in social settings in their apartments and homes and transmitting this disease, and it's a very serious situation. We are encouraged because the school administration is taking action for accountability for students. The student body has this really creative effort to encourage students to be responsible. They have a bunch of signs, one of which is, I thought, pretty impressive, is don't be a COVID idiot. And so they're using a little peer pressure to get their colleagues to avoid these social situations that are so dangerous. And lastly, the Pullman Police Department is writing infractions, $250 a pop, for people who have had these illicit get-togethers. And that's having an impact. It's getting the message across. And their city council is considering adding that sanction to people who go to such an event. So the Pullman community is pulling together to try to get on top of this pandemic. The reason I mention this is Pullman has been hit this way because they're the first college that has opened up. But this is a problem that could happen at any of our colleges. We know the University of Washington had an outbreak in some of their Greek system before. So this is just not an issue with Washington State Cougars. And we are calling upon everyone in these college communities to be active to prevent these social
activities when students come back to college in the next few weeks. This is absolutely pivotal. We had our briefing today about the status of this disease, and we're doing relatively well reducing our numbers, but this college outbreak in Pullman has just been an astronomical climb in the number of cases we have. So we're looking forward to college presidents, college student bodies, municipal police departments, business leaders to come together to not see what happened in Pullman to happen in other cities. I'll be talking to college presidents in the upcoming days. In this regard, I want to thank President Schultz for his leadership on this.
Next question comes from Steve with Coma 4.
Hi, thank you. A question for the governor. I know that over the past couple of days, you've mentioned on some of your visits that the state spends millions of dollars to thin out forests as kind of a preventative measure. I'm curious with how severe the wildfire seasons have been over the past several years, why that hasn't been more of a priority, and are there plans or at least discussions in place to try to increase that activity?
Well, I believe there has been an increase over the last several years. I think, don't hold me to this, I think the number for prevention is about $16 million out of a $245 million fire budget. And it would not shock me if we look for increases in the days to come for that activity. But the reason there isn't more is because we have schools that we've had to put up billions of dollars into and billions of dollars into homelessness issues or millions of dollars. There are just so many competing issues. But we are united. This is not a controversial issue in our state. There is really not any political debate about the appropriateness of doing this kind of management, and that's a good thing. So in answer to your question, it would not surprise me if there is talk about increasing this, but I also want to realize that we have several billion-dollar hole in our budget caused by the COVID pandemic. And at the moment, we are not getting help from the U.S. Congress, which is very, very disappointing. Every state in the country, Republican and Democrat, has billion-dollar deficits that they need help on to run their schools, to run their fire suppression, to run their forest management programs. And at the moment, it does not look like Congress is acting. I hope that they will continue to pursue every option to help us out in this regard.
Steve, would you like to ask a follow-up?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay. Next question comes from Carolyn with the South Seattle Emerald.
Hi, yes, Governor. Forgive me if this sounds similar to Rachel's question, but I was curious if the state is coordinating at all with cities to prepare evacuation and or smoke shelter assistance for folks experiencing homelessness.
Well, Kathy, I'm not sure there's a state plan in specifically for that purpose. Could you help on that, Kathy?
Yeah, I can say that currently the Department of Health is providing some technical assistance to our local health departments who are considering setting up shelters to help people come in out of the smoke. And there are some, some good recommendations, from the Centers for Disease Control about all the things you need to think about when you're bringing people in during the pandemic. So, for example, you want to screen people, for symptoms before bringing them into a shelter, make sure that they're wearing face coverings, make sure that you can, maintain some physical distance, and hopefully, if you stand up a shelter, have a lower occupancy than you might normally have, make sure you're doing environmental cleaning. And then we're also talking about ventilation systems in certain buildings and how, ventilation systems can be optimized to protect people against poor air quality, but also protect them, from COVID as well, when they're indoors.
By the way, I'd like to add something. The previous question was about our forest management programs. There is a really important point we have to realize about this. There is no forest management or thinning program that could have protected probably the bulk of these fires that we've experienced the last few days. And the reason is that they really have not been predominantly in our state or national forests. They have predominantly been grassland and brushland and mixed pine trees with brush and grass. And the grass itself is what has been burning down houses. I don't think people understand that grass itself can create walls of flame to take out whole developments. And we're not going to be out mowing the yard of every native grassland in the state of Washington. And so this thinning can help us to some degree reduce what are called stand replacement fires. But it is not a solution for the vast number of fires that we have recently experienced, because they are brush and grass fires, at least in significant part, and they are not in our national or state forests. And so we just cannot rely on that for a solution. The solution is to attack the more fundamental problem, which is it's like we've had this pouring gasoline all over the state of Washington and then being surprised when we have giant fires. And that gasoline is climate change. It's turned grass into the functional equivalent of this, you know, if not gasoline, is something perhaps approaching that. And that's what we have to get on top of. And I'm looking forward to making progress on that.
Carolyn, would you like to ask a follow-up?
So what I mean by this, these are not wildfires in the sense that they're caused by some natural process. This has just never happened in the state of Washington before. This is not natural. This is not an act of God. This is not something that happened because of evolution or meteorological conditions that would have been here without our industrial base. This has happened because we have changed the climate of the state of Washington in dramatic ways. I'm 69 years of age. I have never woken up with smoke 3 out of the last 5 years choking my grandchildren. I've never seen ash in our cars before. How many people have seen major fires in Sumner and Bonnie Lake? This is an entirely new situation, and it is caused by climate change. And so I'm pointing this out because I am frankly not accepting of allowing people's houses to get burned down anymore. I've been governor for 8 years. I've seen too many people who've lost their houses. I've seen too many couples standing in the ash of their homes crying about their losses. That's not acceptable in this state. And we should rise and attack these fires at their source. And I hope that we will do that.
Carolyn, do you have a follow-up?
Yes, I was wondering as well, are there any coordinated evacuation plans as well in place that the state is coordinating with cities or towns or with regards to folks living unsheltered?
General, do you want to address that issue?
Sure, I'll take a shot at that, Governor. So, you know, all these crises are starting out locally, and so the local emergency management office and the individual town, city, or county should have some plans in place, and they do. And so it's really just a matter of the locals implementing their evacuation plans, and if they need assistance with that, then they can contact the state, and we're standing by to assist further with evacuation. But it all starts locally, and that's just the way we do business here in the state. Thanks for the question.
This is very challenging for our fire departments because you don't know where the fire is going to come from. It could come from the northeast or the southwest. And so it's very difficult, and I want to applaud our emergency providers. I may have mentioned this, that Mike Melcher, who is a deputy, I think I mentioned this, from Whitman County, helped evacuate everybody in this town without loss of life or serious injury. This has been tremendous work by all our emergency personnel.
Time for one last question.
Last question comes from Courtney with Northwest News Network.
Hi, Governor. I'm wondering if you can expand on some of the ways you would like to fight some of this climate change. You'd mentioned clean jobs earlier, but what are some other things you would like to see happen?
Well, this is a longer discussion, obviously, but by and large, what we need to do in our state is unite everyone to commit to not allow our neighbors' homes to burn down, to not suffer them this tremendous trauma of the loss of your home. I think it's something that can unite us.
And that means to reduce the carbon pollution that causes the climate to change, that causes the grass to become so dry, that causes a wall of flame to sweep over Malden, Washington. And that means to do all of the things that make sense where we can grow jobs doing clean energy that doesn't have carbon pollution. It was interesting from just a little ways down the road from Malden towards Rosalia, you can look out and you can see on the ridge lines wind turbines that were spinning when I was there, generating perfectly clean electricity. And more importantly, they were generating jobs, really good paying jobs, building them and maintaining them, and also generating revenue for the farmers to lease their fields for these wind turbines. And I just, it was interesting because as I was driving out of town, I realized I'd seen what happens if you don't fight climate change, which you see a town burn down. And I saw what can happen to avoid climate change, which is to put people to work building wind turbines. And we need to do more of that. And that means we need to have policies to put people to work in these good paying jobs, good union jobs. We've done a lot in the state of Washington in this regard. We've got the best efficiency standards in the country for buildings. We have a commitment for clean energy now in our electrical grid. We've done some good work in allowing people to plug in their electric cars, but we need to do more. We need to reduce the carbon pollution coming from our transportation system. So we need a clean fuel standard so that the gas companies are obligated to give us cleaner fuels with less pollution. There's just one of the things we need to do, and I know that there are many as well. Now, we need the whole world to be involved in this effort. But the world, by and large, is involved in this effort. And I'm glad to be in a state that's helping lead the nation in this direction.
Yes, in regards to some of the earlier questions on firefighting capabilities and preventative measures like thinning and prescribed burns and how that might be funded, I'm wondering how that might be prioritized within a tight budget this upcoming session.
Well, I'm sure that the recent fires are going to have an impact on legislators as they wrestle with all the priorities in our state. I know that will be on their minds, and they'll have to figure out the right amount, looking at consideration of all our other priorities in the state. And they will have a difficult job because today we have billions of dollars of holes in our budget already without increasing dollars. So I know that this will be top of mind.
Last words, Governor?
No, thank you. I hope you will be safe, particularly, and tend to your health and your families. And wash your hands, mask up, and be safe this weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.